Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of All About Disasters. I'm your host, Ivan.
And I'm Syed.
I'm Edwin.
Before we move on, we'd just like to thank our sponsor, Apple Studios. Apple Studios is a small indie group composed of university students that are dedicated to creating an immersive gaming experience. Follow their Instagram at bellabock.official for the latest updates on their upcoming game. Today, we have a special guest, Professor Kyle Bord, an ex-professional NBA player on the Detroit Pistons, and is now a geologist.
Hello, gentlemen. I hope you all had a pleasant Monday morning. My name is Kyle Bord, an NBA player turned geologist, and I'm here to ask you fine experts about tsunami. I also seem to have caught a cough while taking my dust-based rocket ship here, so bear with me, please. I guess let's start off with, what are tsunamis exactly?
Yes, our morning was excellent. Thank you for asking, Kyle. Tsunamis are one of the deadliest natural disasters that can cause widespread destruction, threatening not only lives but entire cities. They are a sequence of enormous waves that are caused by violent underwater disturbances along the shore and in the ocean.
Yeah, exactly, and one of the most devastating tsunamis in recorded history was the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami. A large earthquake had propelled a series of tsunamis with waves up to 100 feet and struck 11 coastal countries. On the screen right now is a picture of the aftermath, and you can see how the tsunami completely devastated the town.
Dang, I had no clue about the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, mainly because I was only 3 years old at the time.
Yep, it took the lives of over 230,000 people and wiped out entire towns and ecosystems. This not only showcases the power tsunamis can have, but also the need to predict tsunamis in order to mitigate damages and, more importantly, save human lives.
That sounds so devastating to all things in the area. I'm sure all living and non-living things would be affected, right? What spheres would tsunamis interact with the most?
So, tsunamis are able to affect all five spheres of the Earth, all of which interact with each other. Those spheres are biosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere, asthenosphere, and geosphere. The rapid movement and displacement of water from one area to the next affects the hydrosphere. The vast amount of weight and pressure comes from the immense waves that weather down and erode the solid rocky surfaces of the lithosphere.
Oh, that's true. The sheer amount of water being displaced could have a heavy influence on even the hardest of surfaces.
Yep, you are right with that. Also, the biosphere is impacted as the waves can destroy habitats and displace plants, animals, and humans. The anthroposphere is disrupted as tsunamis can destroy human infrastructure such as cities, farms, and transportation networks.
Wow, that's so sad for all living things involved. You know, I also heard the atmosphere can be affected somehow, even though tsunamis are just made out of water.
Well, the atmosphere can be affected for sure, but inadvertently in a way through damaged human facilities, for example. Like, if a factory is destroyed in gases, oils, or anything that may have a negative impact on the environment would be released, and that can impact the atmosphere.
I never even thought of that, to be honest. Well, how can tsunamis form in the first place then? Those giant waves don't just sprout out of nowhere, right?
So, in general, they're formed from violent tectonic activities. This activity is most prevalent along convergent plate boundaries, but they can also be formed by landslides and volcanic activity, which results in large displacements of water.
So when a heavier plate subducts beneath the lighter plate into the mantle, it results in tension to build up over time and displacement of the adjacent plate. These tensional forces exceed both plates and result in the snapping and uplift of the seafloor, which then releases massive amounts of kinetic energy and vertically displaces the surrounding water. The image on the screen shows the first step in tsunami formation, where the uplift of the seafloor will vertically displace the water above.
This vertical displacement of water can be less than a meter in height, but it covers a wide area. The vertical displacement of water is converted to horizontal displacement as it is brought back down because of gravity and is split into tsunami waves that travel inwards towards the ocean and waves that travel towards the coastline.
The tsunami moving towards the coastline can initially be only 30 centimeters in height, but can travel at really fast speeds ranging from 500 to 800 kilometers per hour. As it approaches shallow waters, it results in wave shoaling, where waves encounter compression due to the absence of a large body of water, which would transverse the energy of the waves. This decreases the wavelength and speed of the wave, while the height of the wave can drastically increase up to 100 feet. The first section of the wave that reaches the shore is called the trough, which appears when water recedes further away from the land, which is a good indication that tsunami is coming.
Wait, so are we able to predict tsunamis at all then? I mean, governments would want to save as many lives as possible, right? And they could at the very least warn people about an incoming tsunami, so how can they tell if one is on the way?
Although direct tsunami prediction cannot be done, its associated causes can be analyzed and monitored. Factors like ocean earthquakes cause tectonic movement that can create large waves and potential tsunamis. Special Coast Guard gadgets and buoys in the ocean are used to detect the rapid pressure changes produced by moving tsunamis.
To add to that, regions that are high in tsunami activity are actively being monitored by tsunami warning centers. These centers alert authorities and citizens of the potential target areas. Levels of severity are indicated by four levels: information statement, watch, advisory, and warning. Seismic systems, used by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administrations, or NOAA, monitor for seismic activity that is then used to determine if a tsunami will form. An example of this, acting out in 2020, where NOAA successfully detected the first as well as the largest peak of the Mexican tsunami. The diagram you see on the screen is another system called the Deep Ocean Assessment and Reporting of Tsunami, or DART-2, which uses wave tracking to predict if a tsunami is in motion.
So then, can anything be done to stop a tsunami, or at least mitigate them and their path of destruction?
Unfortunately, tsunami mitigation or stopping a tsunami in general is not feasible. Mitigating tsunami damage can be performed though.
Hazard mitigation plans are common for high-risk areas and are used to decrease the risk of coastal populations being affected. Education and tsunami warning systems inform the people of dangers, signals, and warnings to provide enough time for them to escape to the high ground.
Physical defenses built into buildings such as seawall barriers and breakwaters are used to decrease the potential damage inflicted by tsunami waves. Finally, post-tsunami plans developed by the government can improve the speed and effectiveness of the rescue efforts and restorations in the affected area.
Okay, so let me double check to see if I have all this down. Tsunamis remain one of the most dangerous types of natural disasters that affect all living things in this path. Direct prediction and mitigation of tsunamis are either ineffective or impossible. And at the moment, the only way we can actually deal with the threat is by educating the public, creating efficient hazard plans, and building coastal defenses, right?
Yep, you have most of it correct, but also, it's important to understand that the magnitude of the tsunami impacts the area and the whole world, as economic and environmental damage is often irreversible.
To add, research should be directed towards new ways of predicting tsunamis, since the best way to save lives is by increasing the time people have before the tsunami waves hit the shore.
Wow, this was a really great interview, you guys. I will definitely keep tsunami education in mind since I live very, very close to the coast.
Thank you for coming to our podcast, Professor Kyle Board. And thank you, the audience, for tuning in to another episode of All About Disasters. Roll the credits.